Welcome to part three of this series, rebutting the article, Is Evolution Scientific? From the new and improved Answers in Genesis, Creation Ministries International. A new name, an improved website, and all of the same completely lame content as before. In this part, they attempt to use logic to refute evolution. It becomes clear right off the bat that they don't even know what logic is. Consider their opening paragraphs. Imagine you open your front door and see a robot walking on two legs along the street carrying a package. The package is marked with an address that the robot has followed and arrived at. Glancing at your neighbor, you say, "Who do you think made the robot?" To which he says, "I don't think anyone made it. I think it made itself." With even a layperson's knowledge of basic engineering, would this be a logical conclusion? Yep. The only logic they have is fallacious, an argument from incredulity. The reason why we know the robot to be artificial is because of two things. One, we have seen human beings create robots, and we can study the process by which they do it. And two, because we know of no natural process whatsoever that results in robots. It is for those reasons, and no other, that it is logical to conclude that human beings made the robot. Of course, modern robots are actually programmed with evolutionary algorithms, instead of having their software designed directly by humans, but we won't get into that right now. They try to relate this to the kinesin molecule, seen here as rendered in the worst documentary ever, Expelled. They say that this walking motion means that the molecule must have been designed, just as the robot should have. There's a problem. The kinesin molecule doesn't move like this at all. The kinesin molecule moves through electromagnetic forces. The end of the molecule is polar and moves along as certain molecules called ATP bind to the tube. The free leg of the kinesin molecule twists around randomly until it gets close enough to the ATP molecule to bind to it. The ADP molecule then releases the other foot, which itself twists around randomly until it finds another ATP molecule to bind to. Even this animation is simplifying things. The ATP and ADP molecules do not show up regularly, and sometimes they get put in the wrong place, making the kinesin molecule go backwards. The result is a complex jittery motion backwards and forwards that eventually goes more forwards than backwards. If anyone made a robot to walk like this, they'd be busted instantly back down to the assembly line. They then go with the old standard, the flagellar motor, debunked by Ken Miller at the Dover trial. What Creation Ministries International is dancing around here without stating it is the long-refuted standby of intelligent design, known as irreducible complexity.
The bacterial flagellum looks like a sort of Jules Verne notion of what the future looks like. It has a strange sort of mechanical quality to it, these sort of cogs and waving tails and stuff.
And according to Behe, if any one of these parts is missing from the system, the motor can't function.
Have other scientists acknowledged these design features of the flagellum?
Yes, they have. If you could advance the next slide. In 1998, a man named David DeRosier makes a statement, quote, "More so than other motors, the flagellum resembles a machine designed by a human," close quote. So David DeRosier also recognizes that the structure of the flagellum appears designed.
What I wrote was, this is a machine that looks like it was designed by a human, but that doesn't mean it was designed. That is the product of intelligent design. Indeed, this more has all the earmarks of something that arose by evolution.
Michael Behe has argued that the flagellum could not have evolved since its parts have no function for natural selection to act on until they are fully assembled. But evidence that refutes Behe's claim of irreducible complexity comes from a tiny syringe that injects poison, found in some of the nastiest of all bacteria.
This is a structure found, for example, in Yersinia pestis, the bacterium that causes the bubonic plague. And look at the similarities. Now, this structure doesn't rotate, but it still has to extend this structure, which is equivalent to the rod, the drive shaft here. It has to extend that because it needs this little channel. It's like sort of like a syringe. So the virulence factors that are made inside the cell, which is down here, can be exported, pushed up into this hole, and exported out through this long kind of needle, perhaps into a cell in your body or mine, and thereby create misery.
And it turns out the two structures look similar for a reason. The syringe on the right is made of a subset of the very same protein types found in the base of the flagellum on the left. Though the syringe is missing proteins found in the motor and therefore cannot produce rotary motion, it functions perfectly as an apparatus for transmitting disease.
So if we think about what it means to be irreducibly complex, the argument is that if you take away even one of these proteins, that the structure cannot function. And yet here is a structure that functions, that is missing several of the proteins, and yet here it is, a working viable organelle of the bacterium. So indeed, this structure is not, in that sense, irreducibly complex.
CDK007 has this video on the evolution of the flagellum. Evolution has been shown to produce irreducibly complex structures, as this further video from CDK007 shows. They attempted to refute evolution with logic, but in reality, all they did was make a logical fallacy and support it with claims that just aren't true. So their logic is wrong, but is evolution logical? The answer is yes. And the only evidence you need for confirmation is in the evolutionary algorithms mentioned earlier. Here are some creatures evolved using an evolutionary algorithm written by Lee Graham. The simulation begins with random creatures that can't do any more than fall over and maybe wiggle. These amazing and beautiful creatures evolved from those using nothing more than mutation and natural selection. This has practical benefits. I mentioned earlier that robots are now using evolutionary algorithms, and some experts say this will be the new wave in AI. They've also been used to design everything from designs for Audi and Mercedes-Benz and many others, to this antenna for NASA's new generation of satellites. These solutions produce designs far better, far more quickly, and far more cheaply than any human designers can manage. Is evolution logical? Check. In part 4, we'll look at their accusation that scientists have closed off the avenue of criticism towards the theory of evolution.